Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Erich Kurschat. I'm the owner of Harmony Insights, LLC, a company that allows me to work with organizations and consultants using the DISC personality assessment, which a lot of companies are using online right now to engage and develop remote workforces. You can complete DISC assessments virtually and bring people together virtually for workshops that would normally happen face-to-face. You can find out more about that at harmonyinsights.com. I'm also the founder of HR Hot Seat, which is an inclusive mastermind community of what we call real HR pros solving real HR problems. And so if you are an HR professional yourself or you serve HR professionals, you can join the community for free at hrhotseat.com. Create a community profile there and then join a local chapter that would be convenient for you. Tonight, as it turns out, we have a HR Hot Seat Chicago virtual mastermind event going on. I think the third in a row that we've done, and we have maxed out 100 registrants for it. So I'm really excited to bring people together tonight on Zoom for that conversation. I know some of our attendees today are going to be a part of that. What you are attending right now is a Harmony Insights lunch date. And as I've been telling it over the past few weeks, I just decided I needed to bring people together for some really inspiring conversation. A lot going on in the world right now, and I wanted to connect with people who inspire me for 30 minutes of my lunch hour here in the central time zone between 12 and 12:30 so that I could go into my afternoon inspired to do my best work. So it's a bit selfish, but I'm excited about it, and I'm especially excited to have you with me and to have you meet our featured guest for today's Harmony Insights lunch date, Jennifer Tardy from Jennifer Tardy Consulting. Welcome, Jennifer.
Hi, thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
All right. Well, as I've told you, I'm only going to people that inspire me, that I've had great conversations with in the past, and you've made that short list. So I am so excited to introduce you to folks and introduce them to you today. I want to thank you so much for being a part of this conversation and invite you to let our attendees know a little bit about you and your background and what positions you well for this conversation today that we are titling Learning and Sharing Your Smoke Signals.
Yes. Yeah, so thank you for having me. I'm so excited to be here. I feel like I've been on like a virtual speaking circuit, and this is the first time I'm able to finally talk about this topic today because I think it's so important. But a little bit about me. I've been in the HR world for the last 14 years. A few years ago, I left corporate America to start my own boutique consulting organization where I not only coach job seekers, people who are on their job search, but I also consult with organizations who want to implement diversity recruiting programs. And so it keeps me really busy. And I also, as a serial entrepreneur, I also have a third organization that's a mental health organization, where our clinicians actually go out in the field to help people who are Medicaid recipients to get connected to community resources. So all of that keeps me very busy, but it all kind of, it works together to better help me to support my clients.
So what you're saying is you're not just sitting around on the couch all day.
No. Okay. And I have a 2- and 3-year-old, so they wouldn't dare let me just sit around on the couch at all.
Where are they now? Are they running around in the background, or have you got them put away in a room?
I don't know. They're in daycare right now.
Okay. So, well, they're welcome to join us. They're welcome to join us.
No, fortunately, because of some of the work that I do, they're able to still go to daycare. So that's very, very helpful.
Good. Gives you a little space for some of the stuff that you're working on.
That's right.
I've been asking, starting out by asking our featured guests, we've all been impacted in some way by the coronavirus, COVID-19. Some of us are working from home when we haven't before. Some of us have had to care for loved ones who have been impacted in other ways. Are you willing to share briefly some way in which you have personally been impacted by what's going on right now?
Absolutely. So I haven't started seeing the negative impacts on my business from COVID. As a matter of fact, because there have been so many layoffs and furloughs, it's an increasing amount of people are looking for career coaches because they want to be competitive. So I'm actually juggling about working with around 15 executives where we're doing private coaching to really make sure that they can stand out, right? So from that standpoint, I'm not seeing the impact. I do believe that there will eventually be an impact in some of the work that I'm doing. But then on the other hand, as I'm consulting organizations to train their recruiters, right now they're using this as an opportunity to say, okay, diversity is important. We still want to continue to increase diversity. What can we do even once we start back hiring again? So I'm seeing that there. Now, my partner on the other end, he had a catering company with a food truck business associated to it. And so just like that overnight, you know, with no meetings that are happening, he's seeing all of his catering contracts, they're all coming to an end. And so it's like night and day.
I'm sure.
The work that we're both doing, so.
I'm sure. You and I have talked in the past about how misleading it can be, or at least work to your disadvantage when you're reading these headlines all day long about how no companies are hiring. You and I have talked about, well, it's actually misleading. This may be the very best time for candidates to make themselves known and be top of mind for those organizations that they would like to work for. That unfortunately is not the focus of our conversation today. It may work in. I feel like you and I could go in any number of directions, whether it's diversity, job transition, so much we could discuss, but we are talking today about smoke signals. And I love that. I love that term because I don't hear it being used at all. So I don't know if this is something that you have coined, but I would love to hear from you. Just a little bit about this passion that you have for this conversation around identifying, defining, acknowledging, communicating smoke signals.
Yeah, so it actually came to be very, I wasn't looking for this message, but with the clients that I work with a lot of leaders who are highly ambitious. And when people are highly ambitious, you know, we're on it. And when the world is not in pandemic, they're stretched thin, they're balancing a lot, and I'm always talking to them about self-care. So now that we're in the season of COVID, I'm having a different conversation with them, and I'm saying, okay, you may have been Superman or Superwoman before, but I really, really want you to prioritize self-care in this season. It's truly important. And one of the books that really made me think about it, and I usually never had this book, and I happen to think about it now. So I don't know have you ever read The Four Agreements?
No, I have not.
And I see Randall shaking his head. It's a very short read, and it just talks about four agreements for a really good personal, to have personal freedom. One of the agreements in particular talks about always do your best and how remembering that your best may look different under different circumstances. So when you're not feeling well, your best will look different than if you're absolutely feeling great physically. But you have to be able to give yourself grace when you're not feeling well. And so those that I work with that are highly ambitious, we don't give ourselves grace. As a matter of fact, we're the ones beating ourselves up more, believing that we need to still be as great and as ambitious and as successful within a pandemic as we were outside of a pandemic. Mm-hmm. And so it led me to the conversation about who knows when you need some support. Because odds are, and just putting it in context of a job search, who even knows that you're looking for a job right now? Because in your past, most people came to you for help. Mm-hmm. And you've been so great with assisting everyone in your circle with helping them get connected and helping them find jobs. But now when it's your turn, you know, there's the resistance, there's the hesitation. And so that's help by way of your job search. But what about help by way of you're drowning in this season? And so then I started thinking about, well, who would know your smoke signals so that you haven't drowned before someone actually discovers you? And then the next question is, do you know your own smoke signals? Do you know, you know, when you're about to drown on your own? So for me, for instance, because it never just happens that you wake up one day and you're underwater. There are little bitty things that happen. And I know one of the first things for me is I'll find it harder to get out of bed. So it's not impossible, but what I may wind up doing is, okay, I'll just take out my laptop and I'll work out of my bed today. And then the next thing would be, okay, well, you know, maybe before I go to bed this evening, I'll have a glass of wine or another glass of wine, right? Little things that start adding up, or maybe I'll start eating more chips. And so I'll go off of my healthy diet, but all of those things start building up. And if you don't realize that you're in trouble, then how can you help yourself? And if someone else doesn't realize that you're in trouble, then how can they help you too? So that's kind of where that came from.
I feel like this, a lot of this is familiar to me. It's a slightly different language for some of what I'm used to, but it's introspection in the same way. It's some level of self-awareness that in order to be effective in whatever we're doing, I strongly believe that we have to start from a place of self-awareness. And for me, that a lot of that language comes from the DISC personality assessment that I use. But in the workshops that I'm a part of, we often talk about, you know, you may want to help other people, you want to be strong for other people, but unless you first have a sense of who you are, how you are uniquely wired, what you value and prioritize, what your tendencies are, it's going to be potentially more difficult for you to show up for others in the way that they need you to show up. So in terms of the challenges that we want to make sure that we're identifying for our potential challenges for our attendees today, what are some of the challenges that you think people are facing around first knowing themselves and being self-aware in a way that allows them to then go to step two, which is communicating those smoke signals to others?
Yeah. So one of the things that we haven't been doing, number one, we don't slow down. And so being able to slow down first and ask yourself, how do I cope? So when things aren't feeling good for me, when things aren't going well for me, what do I typically turn to cope? And that is, and most people don't want to look at the ugly, right? We want to think that every single time that something goes wrong, that we'll go for a jog, or every single time that something goes wrong, you know, we'll go and meditate. That may be what other people can see, but you know your other side. So being able to answer the question, how do I cope? And being able to slow down to be present enough when something is going wrong to ask yourself, well, in this moment, how am I coping? Mm-hmm. So paying attention to your coping mechanisms. And then from there, being able to say, okay, so here's how I cope. And then to your point, step two is being able to share that with someone else, with a loved one that you trust, that won't abuse it or weaponize it, right? It's really hard for us to share that other side of us because we don't want someone to take advantage of it. But there's actually a third step to this too that I've been thinking about a lot. Not only do we need to share it with the loved one, we need to give our loved one permission to push in if they see those signals. Because again, when we're the strong ones, other people will think, oh, they'll figure it out, or oh, they've got it. And I remember I had just had a conversation with one of my friends and one of my girlfriends who actually, she moved in for 3 months while she was building her course. That's another subject. And so as she was in my guest room, in my guest bedroom, I was in the middle of taking on this massive project, in which, you know, I started eating unhealthy again. I started, you know, doing some other things. And so I didn't go to the gym 2 days in a row. And she happened to peep her head into my room and she said, hey, you think you wanna, she, whatever way she said it was so nice. And she was like, do you think you wanna go to the gym today? It may make you feel a lot better. And I was like, oh my goodness, that is such a good idea. And so she decided to go to the gym with me, which got me right back in my routine. But even if she saw my smoke signals, if I didn't give her permission to push in, to say something, then I don't think she would have.
I love that. There's so much for us to unpack here, and I'm eager to get further into it. I've created an easy and quick poll that you're welcome to, our attendees are welcome to contribute to, and it asks, how comfortable are you asking for support when you need it? And as people respond to that, you've already said so many things, Jennifer, that I would love to spend some time on. We're going to have to be very judicious about what we choose to unpack. But I like the theme that I'm hearing so far, that so much of what we're discussing is noticeable. It's a specific behavior or a feeling or something that you can see or that others can see. It's in your head, it may be a feeling that's hard to put into words and hard to put into behaviors, but it sounds like a lot of what you're saying is, for example, you know, it's harder for you to get out of bed. You may not know what that means necessarily, but if you're paying attention to that being abnormal in some way, at least for your routine, you can start to get a sense of, wait, this might mean something, you know? And if someone else can recognize that you aren't doing this physical thing, this action of going to the gym like you normally would, doesn't necessarily mean anything is wrong, but if they feel that they have the ability and your permission to say something about that and bring it up, it could start a very important conversation about things that are maybe a little bit off kilter in your world.
That's right. That's right. And I would even say that the very last piece of this, that one, after they push in, they must also know how to help you win. And that's only something that you can share with them in advance too. So my friend saying, hey, go to the gym, she knew that the gym would be something to kind of pep me up to get back into my structure again. It's a big thing. Or for instance, I love juicing. And so, you know, if she sees me not juicing and she's like, hey, have you considered moving your juicer back onto your counter? Because maybe seeing it will help you get back into juicing. And so those things, I know that there are certain things for me that help me to win. So being able to also divulge that information to a person that you love and you trust can help them to help you win too.
It sounds like this is somebody who knows you fairly well, and I love at least how you've set it up. I love her approach. It doesn't sound like there was any judgment associated with it. She didn't say, hey, lazy bones, why aren't you at the gym, right? She just acknowledged, this is something that I know is important to you.
But she
doesn't even sound like she asked you why you weren't doing it. She was just offering her perspective on how you could do it. Is that right?
That's right. But the key here is the only reason that she knew me that well was because I shared those things with her directly. It was a very direct conversation that I said, on 99% of the time, I'm actually good. I'm okay. But that 1% of the time, here's how you can tell when there's an SOS, when I'm screaming for help, or when there's a smoke signal.
Yeah.
And the reason why I'm talking about this now, because I do talk about this to all of my clients in their job search. And it's because, again, going through a job search is a very emotional process. Going through a career transition in general can be a deeply emotional process, and it can cause us to cope in ways that aren't really healthy for us, or that may not be our standard. And so I do want to make that connection here, that the reason why we're talking about this is because, you know, people that I'm talking to, and I can even tell on this call too, are highly ambitious individuals who are probably the center of giving help and support to others. But I really, really think it's very important and very valuable that other people are there to support you as well too.
Yeah. I'm going to share the results of the poll. 17% of our attendees today said that they are very comfortable asking for support when they need it. 50% say somewhat, and then 33% say it's complicated, which I've decided needs to be just sort of a standard option in some of these surveys. It's complicated.
I agree. I love that.
So, and that's kind of what I would expect. You know, we all like to think of ourselves or would hope to be comfortable asking for support when we need it. But I think we can all agree it's more easily said than done. It strikes me as you're talking that, you know, we're talking about people that we love and trust and who love and trust us, that it's easier to open up to these people. I think it's probably helpful if they are sort of naturally observant, so you don't have to give them the answers to the test. You know, you're more naturally observant. Family members and friends might be able to pick up on some of this stuff a little bit more easily without you having to make it so explicit. What happens if we are going to the wrong people? What if we are hoping for support from, or even asking for support from, people that maybe don't have our best interests in mind, or who don't know us so well? Or it seems to me that not only may we not get the response that we're hoping for, but it could also go the opposite direction. It could work to our disadvantage if we are opening up to or inviting people in where we haven't established that level of trust. Do you understand what I'm asking?
Yeah, right. So it's one of the reasons why most people don't confide in other people at that deep of a level. It's probably because it's been used against them negatively in the past, or it's been weaponized in the past, or thrown in their face in the past. And now we're like, I don't ever want to experience that again, which is why I'm not a proponent of opening this conversation up to just anyone. I think that it's really important that the person, or maybe the one or two people that you decide to sit and have this conversation with, that they know how difficult this is for you to do, because it's difficult for all. I don't know a person that that's like, oh, it's easy for me to share my shadow side.
Shadow side.
Right. I make up a lot of words along.
It works. I love it.
It's not simple to share that side. And perhaps it's someone, and I like that you picked up on it related to my friend, Erica is her name, that I've seen her and I've witnessed how she handles people when they're going through difficult times, when there are disagreements or disruptions or things like, how does she approach those situations, whether it's with me or whether it's with someone else? So she started demonstrating it enough that allowed me to want to give her a chance. So it's not just something, I had a best friend of 30 years. It wouldn't have been something that I would give to her, because even if she had the best intention, she's like a bull in a china shop when it comes to when it comes to wanting to help and support. Yeah. So you have to be very intentional about who can actually deliver upon this when it's needed. And I associate it to, this may sound a little morbid, but when you're thinking about your will and who's going to take care of your kids and things like that, you know, you're not just looking at who's a great person. No, you're looking at who can be the type of parent for my children if I'm not around then. It's that type of conversation you need to have with yourself when thinking about choosing the person that can be your SOS person.
And I will speak from experience. I mean, not only personally, but professionally, that there's actually somebody on this call who's attending this call that I know I could go to with any problem. Awesome. And that person knows that I can go to them, or that person knows that they can come to me with any problem. And whether or not we know what's going on, or we've kept in touch, we're there for each other, and we're picking up on those smoke signals that you're talking about. And maybe we're not. Maybe we're just, you know, texting or calling to say, hey, what's going on? We haven't talked in a while. Or I know you're going through something. You know, is there anything you'd like to talk about? And having somebody like that in your life, either personally or professionally, just can make such a world of difference.
One thing that I do want to say, and I like that you said that too, the only thing that I would clarify is whenever I'm talking to my clients, I always say, don't assume that the other person knows how to be there for you, or knows how to tell when they may be able to tell that something is wrong, but they may not know how significant it is. I know that I'm telling a lot of my personal business, but I think it's extremely important. I'm learning to do that as I'm having these conversations. But even when I was going through my divorce several years ago, I remember thinking, how come, you know, my girlfriends at that time didn't push in when I wanted them to push in? And as I started having conversations with them, like, I knew that they loved me. I knew that they wanted to be there for me. They just didn't know how. And they thought that I was doing okay, because I would always have this demeanor of, hey, let's, today's a new day. Let's go and do it. Let's go and get it. But they really didn't know how. And I didn't know that. I was just thinking, how come nobody's pushing in right now? How come nobody's coming in to save me? And sometimes that's what it feels like when life is hitting us. It can oftentimes feel like I need someone to come in and save me right now. But at the same time, we feel that as adults, we shouldn't feel that way, but it does feel that way. So you can't change a feeling. You just have to prepare for that feeling.
So very quickly, given the time that we have left, and it's very short, I want to make sure that we end on a couple of notes. What is one actionable takeaway, one tip that you would give to our attendees, just one and just very briefly, that they can put into practice immediately after this conversation to begin to recognize, acknowledge, or communicate their own smoke signals?
One of the best things that you can do is make a list of how you cope. And a part of making that list is asking yourself the question and just answering the question. But the other part is, when you actually go through something, observing yourself and then adding that to the list too. You may be surprised at how you actually cope when times are hard.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. We are going to follow up, as I mentioned earlier, we're going to follow up with people, or maybe I didn't. We're going to follow up with attendees via email with a list of resources that Jennifer has prepared for us, including that book, Four Agreements, I think it was called.
Absolutely. Four Agreements by Miguel Ruiz.
Wonderful. And maybe one or two other things. Jennifer, in the meantime, I know people will want to be in touch with you to pick your brain, to ask you about potential coaching opportunities and services. How can people find you online?
They can go to jennifertardy.com. I am in the middle of revamping my site, so don't judge me for anything you see on there today. But yes, jennifertardy.com.
Wonderful. And if you've enjoyed this conversation as I have, I hope you will register for future Harmony Insights lunch dates at harmonyinsights.com/lunchdates. Coming up tomorrow, I'm trying something new, a different take on the traditional panel discussion format. So I'm going to invite people to show up and on the spot, choose panelists to speak on the topic of meaningful connection. I haven't seen this done elsewhere. I'm not saying I'm the first to do it, but I know it needs to be attempted, and tomorrow is my attempt to do that. So I would love for you to join us for that. Going into next week, we're gonna have some conversations on discovering your voice, how and why behind LinkedIn and Twitter, for those of us who aren't using them to their full advantage as platforms. And then one of the co-hosts of the HR Social Hour Half Hour podcast, John Thurmond, is going to join us next Friday, I think the 22nd, talking about new ways to nurture your community in challenging times. And so I'm really excited to talk to John. He has a fantastic podcast. As do you, Jennifer. You want to give a quick plug for the podcast that you have and the episode that we did together?
Absolutely. So I have a podcast called But What About Me, which is a career success podcast, taking the perspective of your job search from historically underrepresented populations. And so we take different takes on the job search. And one in particular that was one of my favorites was ours, Eric, where we talked about being an introvert and how to network like an introvert. So what are all the things that you can do to show up well and how it can still be powerful in your networking when you're an introvert?
You were such a great interviewer. I really enjoyed that. I've listened to other conversations as well, and I highly recommend people check out your podcast wherever podcasts are found. If this is it for you and you need to go on to your afternoon, you're certainly welcome to do so. If you want to stick around at this point, we're going to encourage you to unmute yourself and contribute a thought or a question while we have a little bit of additional time with Jennifer. But in the meantime, before people part who need to part, Jennifer, I just want to thank you so much again for joining us for today's Harmony Insights lunch date.
Thanks for inviting me. I appreciate it.